Oh, I wish I was in the land of cotton. Old times there are not forgotten. Look away, look away, look away, Dixieland.
Oh, I wish I was in Dixie.
Away, away, in Dixieland I'll take my stand to live. And I for Dixieland, it's where I was born. Early Lord, one frosty morn, look away.
Still right.
Look away, Dixieland.
revised by John Dickinson, and then Congress has a go at it and, you know, changes everything. The statutory site is Washington.
So they had plans for that decade before, you know.
Well, Franklin did. Nobody else took it seriously. If they'd have followed a Franklin's plan, there might not have been a revolution. His idea was that each of the colonies would actually have representatives to a regional parliament someone would basically
we're in the assembly room where Pennsylvania's legislature met.
They moved upstairs to make way for Congress. Congress began meeting here in May of 1775. It was not until July of 1776 when the men in this room could actually bring themselves to admit that they had exhausted all other options. Independence from Great Britain was the only option they had left. We'd actually been at war with Great Britain for over a year before Congress finally declared independence. And we celebrate the long day. Congress declared independence in this room on the 2nd of July, 1776, when they voted to adopt a resolution proposed by Richard Henry Lee of Virginia. Now, Lee's resolution clearly stated that these United Colonies are and upright ought to be free and independent states. 2 days later, on the 4th of July, Congress voted to adopt the amended text of the Declaration of Independence, written by Thomas Jefferson. The last thing the men in this room were all worried about is which day Americans should all be out celebrating. Well, as far as most of these men were concerned, there was little to celebrate. In declaring independence, they were now formally going to war with the strongest power in Europe. Great Britain had the largest navy in the world, more than 530 warships. The United States had 8. Great Britain had the second largest army in Europe. It was the best trained, it had all the best equipment. The United States had a bunch of militiamen and minutemen who had very little training and even less equipment. No man in this room could have known France was going to be our ally. The French government didn't make that decision for about another year. It very quickly occurred to the members of Congress, achieving independence was going to be much more difficult than simply declaring. Certainly when Congress declared independence here, they had no idea how independence was going to be achieved. Certainly they figured that out here. Congress met here throughout most of the Revolutionary War. 11 years after independence was declared here, the Constitutional Convention came to Philadelphia. They started meeting here in May of 1787, swore themselves to secrecy, and they got down to work. And these men quickly realized that they had to create one thing that terrified them, a strong, powerful central government. They didn't have a choice. They had to create a government that would have the power to tax, a government that would be able to maintain order at home, a government that would be respected abroad. And they figured the only way that could be done safely would be to divide the government into 3 separate branches, the system of checks and balances. You know, the one thing that the Congress, the President, and the Supreme Court always knows for certain is the other two are watching. And if one of those 3 branches does something that they're not supposed to do, if they are not doing something that they are supposed to do, the other 2 branches are going to take action to force the 3rd branch into compliance. It's an amazing idea in the 18th century. So was the idea that one man could be the head of state, the head of government, and the head of the military. You know what? Most European governments divide up between 3 different people. We put all onto the president. And one of the questions that had to be answered here was, how could you grant one man all that power? Allow him to use that power effectively but still limit his power. They came up with a lot of different ideas. One of the most radical to make its way into the Constitution was the idea that although the president is the head of state, he is forced to justify himself to his people at least every 4 years. Every 4 years, he's required to stand for election. Throughout most of the world in the 18th century, to get a new head of state, you went through bloodlines or bloodletting. The old head of state died. The closest living relative then inherited that position. It didn't matter if they were incompetent. It didn't even matter if they were insane. You got the next one in line, unless you're willing to exercise the other option. The people or the government kill the head of state and then put someone else or something else in their place. So another important question here was, is would this new American system work? Would you really expect the president, when he's not been reelected, to just hand all that power over to his successor and just walk away? And you know, quite a few of the men who wrote the Constitution, they were shocked by their own work, and quite a few of them hesitated. Can you blame them? You know, nothing like this had ever succeeded before. Out of the 55 men who wrote the United States Constitution, 39 of them agreed to sign it. They signed it just for this table, is September the 17th, 1787, with George Washington presiding in that very chair. So, again, does anybody have any questions about anything before you go? Anything I've said, anything you've seen?
Is that original chandelier?
One of our curators found that chandelier at an antique shop in London in 1966, and that's about all we know about it. There's reason to believe it looks a lot like the one that was here.
So there was light.
Generally what happened is they met from 10 to 4, Monday through Saturday, And if there's a day that's really overcast, they kind of do the minimum that has to be done and then adjourn and just hope the sun shines brighter tomorrow. So most of these men were to work by sunlight. Although that's not the extent of their day, because just like Congress today, they all served on committees. So you could have committee meetings early in the morning into the same way they do now if something's running up against the deadline. You know, you could have committee meetings that run up to midnight. Yeah, there's each of the 13 tables is one per colony or state. The problem is they were so busy creating a nation they forgot to leave us a seating chart, so we don't know which state sat where. Anyone else? Okay, then just gonna go out the main corridor and step to your left. You're gonna exit out through the tower doors. You have a good day.
Oh, I wish I was in the land of cotton. Old times there are not forgotten. Look away, look away, look away, Dixieland.
Oh, I wish I was in Dixie.
Away, away, in Dixieland I'll take my stand to live and die. For Dixieland, it's where I was born. Early Lord, one frosty morn, look away, look away, look away, Dixieland. Trials, Lord, soon.